It's time to awaken and remember who you really are. It's time to live a life that you absolutely love. And it is time for the Awakened Being. Conversations to create change. Having real, transparent conversations that will change your world. And together, we can change the world. This is Sundari, aka Marcy Locke, here on the Awaken Being Conversations to Create Change. And today we are talking all things boobies. Yeah, all things boobies. That sounds like a great conversation. Going into implants, explants, all the conditioning, the associations around the boobs, conscious to unconscious, you name it. I go into this conversation with my dear divine sister, Katarina Satori, who just had an explant when we got to have this conversation. So super excited to share this with you, as well as know that anytime you can go to marcylocke.com and get the Ultimate Life of Having It All meditation for free to support you, as well as tune into the Best Life Tribe, which has all sorts of goodies and an amazing, dope community of people living their absolute best life. You can also see if there's a specific coaching or meditation or activation that will be of the greatest service for you to be able to assist you in continually moving forward, living your best life of absolute liberation, abundance, and bliss right now, because we are all worthy of that. And together we rise in love. See you soon. Hello, hello, hello. This is Sundari, aka Marcy Locke, for Conversations to Create Change, the Awakened Being. And I'm here with one of my most glorious divine sisters. I call her Sistar. I call her my divine ally, my bestie of light, my soul companion. Such a reflection and a mirror for me, and such a glorious relationship. So this is the divine Katarina Satori.
Ooh. I'll replay this intro a few times.
Yes. And we're talking boobies.
Oh my goodness.
We're talking boobies.
As I'm holding them right now in my
Right,
palms.
I'm going to hold mine too.
Yeah.
Mine are so little and divine and perfect. And what are we talking boobies? We're talking implants, explants. We're talking little boobies, big boobies. We're talking all of it. The whole game of consciousness around it, your spiritual journey. There's just so much here. And in this show, the divine calling for the show was to only have the most authentic, transparent, vulnerable conversations that literally could create a complete change, not only for the frequency in our humanity, for healing of the collective, and also for each person to have a new paradigm of awareness that they could incorporate or resonate to whatever level or degree based on their path and journey. And I'm so only called to have these kind of conversations. And so this is why there's actually, out of all the shows I've done, there's only a few with other people, because it's such a sacred space of who can go that deep with me, and it just being about the depth of this freedom for other people. And it's not like, you know, I told you this isn't the typical podcast. We're like, little. So, I mean, what I will say is there's so much more for each person here that's listening to learn and understand about this divine queen, goddess, priestess, galactic alien, shamanista sister that I'm sitting next to. So to even completely get to hear who she is and her story and the gift she has, it's well worth your time and your value. And we both felt really called to have this conversation. Again, we'll laugh it up about boobies, because Katarina has just gone through explant surgery. And we shared how I've talked about on my journey how when I was at a point where I felt like I looked like a 12-year-old boy, and I had so much about, I had to look a certain way, and I thought being a woman had to look a certain way, and if I had boobs, I'd feel more attractive, I'd be more complete, I'd, you know, all of those things. And through my journey, I realized I wanted that externally because I didn't love myself. It was looking for something to make me feel better about myself. And through my journey, I love my little boobies. I love my perfect boobs. And so I was blessed to find that within. And I also have had many people that I've seen see it as like, oh, I want this, and I'm going to do it as a level of worthiness. And there's people who also choose it as a desire for something else within. Share, please, like what you've been through, and let's just open up the conversation.
Yeah, sister. Well, the main thing, what I've learned through experience of having implants for 11 years, the main reason why I decided to go publicly with my story, I want every woman to be fully informed about the choice and the consequences of that choice. Because when a woman desires to get implants, whether it's a permission slip because she's rewarding herself, she's worthy of that choice, she deserves it. That was my precise language.
Yeah.
I deserve it. I pay for it myself. No sugar daddy pays for it. I was super proud because, you know, 11 years ago, you look in a completely different category. Right? So
Three months ago, I knew a completely different Katarina. A month ago, I knew a completely different Katarina. So yeah, 11 years ago.
Can you imagine 11 years, completely different creature?
Yep.
So I was so proud that I paid for my own implants, that I did not carry the energy of a sugar daddy who bought them for me. And then, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Energetics. But the thing is, I made that choice completely on the emotional decision.
Yeah.
And I had no clue about what the implant's gonna do to my body as a holistic system.
Yeah.
I didn't ask the questions. You know, the surgeon who performed that surgery literally told me it's one of the most safest things you can put in your body. Mm-hmm. If you take care of them well, they're gonna last a lifetime.
Mm-hmm.
Total lie. Mm-hmm. But you know what I mean? So they ride on the emotional wave of a woman who makes a decision, and it's how many billions industry is the implant industry?
Well, it's commercialism. We know that our society operates off of commercialism, which is all based out of you need something to feel fulfilled. You need this product, this thing, you know, the Coke in your hand, the cigarette in your mouth, or this holding someone's hand next to you, etc. You need to look like this, etc. So, of course, all of the, what I didn't know anything about, the effects of implants. And I wouldn't have unless you, as my divine dear sister, started to tune into all these things you were experiencing with your body and how they're affecting you, and then connecting it to, after years and years and years of experiencing all these physical things, connecting it to the implants within your system.
Yeah.
And so, it's like, wow, that's... So, I mean, share what you started to experience. You were just, back then, it was like, I'm worthy of boobs, right?
That's right.
I'm worthy of boobs. And I remember thinking I required them to feel better. And I'm grateful I went through the energy journey to go, oh, I actually don't require the boobs. I love myself. And I've done so many videos where I'm like, I love my little boobs. And people are like, what? And I'm like, yay, they're so perfect. And I do. I love my boobs. I couldn't imagine that at the time. So we can see this confusion between the journey. And all we really want to present here is all the aspects of it. Like,
that's
so that people can make conscious decisions. So when you chose in on that and you were told by society, by marketing, et cetera, by the doctors, it's safe, you'll have it for the rest of your life, you know, et cetera. What was your actual experience?
Yeah. You know, think about when you get a splinter in your finger, what's going to happen? The body naturally will do everything to push it out.
Yeah.
So imagine I gave you to hold the implants, heavy they are.
Well, you were telling me the moment you had them out, your back pain went away.
Yes. Immediately.
She had me hold them. I'm like, whoa. Yeah.
They're heavy. They're like 3 pounds together,
right?
Naturally
would start to curve in your back and it would start to, you know, and it would just become normal.
Yes.
You have that weight there to carry. So that was one.
Exactly. But, you know, the body literally started having a reaction within, you know, I would say a year, you know, and the symptoms build up.
Yeah.
So first year you're like, what's going on? The first symptom is unexpected weight gain.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the 10 pounds out of nowhere, like where is it coming? And it's really difficult to shake it off.
Mm-hmm.
And it actually makes sense because the body's an inflamed state. Mm-hmm. What does it do? It holds to every single ounce of water, right? So you bloated like a fish and the body is inflamed, but you know, it's okay. You could deal with that. That's what I would tell myself. I would work out, I would drink a lot of water, I would eat. But for me, it was a building up fatigue.
Yeah.
Like on a year three with implants, I started getting more and more and more fatigue. I blamed it on building my own business, being very ambitious. I never connected it.
She's a super amazing, I mean, glorious leader and producer in the world that has, I mean, you're such a producer and yet you operate in flow and ease, like we believe. So yeah, you were just attuning that to like, I'm here to lead. I'm here to serve. And of course I wipe myself out or finding that flow with it. Yeah,
exactly. Mm-hmm. Exactly. And you know, I would say the last 2 years, I really began to pay attention to, like, I stopped digesting food normally. Mm-hmm. You know, like I'll eat anything and I want to take a nap. Mm-hmm. Like the food is not digesting. And what happens once again, you know, when you have the implants, it actually correlates to a growth of abnormal bacteria in your body. Mm-hmm. It can also, they also traced it roots of mold. Mm. Mold growing around the implants.
Wow.
So just imagine what all the mold
in your body
will do to your brain.
Right.
You're gonna get brain fog. You're gonna get fatigue, forgetfulness, mm-hmm. And then it's gonna attack your gut. Mm-hmm. And when your gut bacteria is out of balance, you can't digest anything, right?
Your whole system's out of whack when
exactly.
your gut's out of whack.
Exactly. Yeah. But what I could not see is the root. I just start feeling, oh my God, like I'm literally aging so rapidly. One day, I remember I looked myself in the mirror and I saw these huge circles under my eyes. My eyes begin to droop. Like I literally look like I aged 10 years, mm-hmm. you know? And then I was still, I couldn't, like, what's going on here? So chronic fatigue, hormonal mess, you know, adrenals out, thyroid out, weight gain, bloating, inability to digest food. The most frustrating for me was brain fog. Like I told you, like I would sleep 9-10 hours a day, still wake up.
You were
up.
The nap queen.
Oh
was
my
like,
goodness.
You're like, sister, I just nap. I'm like, how do you do that? You're
because
like,
that's the only way I would be able to go through the day.
And you didn't know at the time, you didn't mm-hmm. realize it was, that's what you had to do to survive based on what you were experiencing.
Yeah.
Not like, oh great, I'm worthy of a nap.
Exactly.
all the things we say.
Yeah, yeah. And then, so basically it's funny because you experience this every day and you kind of realize this is how I feel. You forget how good you could feel.
Yeah.
And it becomes like you accept.
It becomes your normal. With any belief system, we become addicted to the chemical experience. We become addicted to, you know, we see it as our normal. So, mm-hmm. yeah.
And then literally a year ago, right, in the summer.
You had them for 11 years.
11 years.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah. So 11 years, you know, and I'm not gonna lie, I loved having them. You know, I got them
very
when I was in my
boobies.
Yeah, they were voluptuous, and I was, you know, I was right at the modeling industry at that time, so I was bikini model and all of that.
Yeah.
Of course, it fit them.
Now she's a spiritual mentor, and she teaches about ascended masters and a sovereign mind, and all sorts of dope ass amazing things. So again, me,
a different
I
type
a
of model.
Yeah,
and you role were model.
Literally bikini model. Yeah,
so it's so
funny.
Good. I love our parallel sister. We just. Such
we're human and we're multidimensional.
I love it.
This is why we're bringing this to the conversation, mm-hmm. is to you realizing where it came from or what you were experiencing and how it was out of alignment with your truest natural system.
Exactly. What it literally felt like an object from an old identity mm-hmm. that was blocking. When I realized the root was in implants, I just looked at the whole situation. Wow, I have 2 plastic bags filled with chemical soap.
Mm-hmm.
Because I had a saline, you can get saline or you can get silicone.
Saline or silicone.
That's
the Russian
silicone.
Accent. Sexy Russian accent. I'll translate. Sexy American accent.
No. Yeah. They tell you that saline is better than silicone, but what they don't tell you that every single implant, doesn't matter what it's made of, it comes in silicone shell.
Yeah.
So if you just Google the effect of silicone into your body, it's a neurotoxin, you know? So no wonder, like there were so many times, like I would have forgetfulness. Mm. I would lose coherence of my expression. It was very frustrating. I was like, am I freaking aging this bad? You know, like an old woman. I felt like an old woman.
Mm.
It was really frustrating.
Yeah.
So when I heard literally the voice of my angels and my spirit guides last year, I heard the voice, it's time to take your implants out. Mm-hmm. I was like, what? And I'm Claire, what do you...
Did I hear that right? Let me sit up. What did you say, Ascended Master? What about my boobs?
Take them out.
I love that.
Yeah. But one thing I've learned, you know, being on this path is when you receive a very clear instructions from the spirit world, you don't question it. You go and you implement. So the very next thing I saw when I logged in on Facebook was a post from one of my fellow spiritual leaders and visionaries who were very public with her story. Mm-hmm. And she was sharing about this thing called breast implant illness.
And I wasn't aware of it at all until you brought it to my attention and started sharing with me what you were learning and why you were experiencing all these things. Because I know we'd done the dance where we talked about fasting. We talked about all these things. Yeah. And you're like, I'm experiencing this, sister. What? And, you know, sharing, like, ideas and support. And then you're like, oh, my gosh, it's my implants. Mm-hmm. All these symptoms. And I was like, what?
Yeah, I remember I was texting you with all the symptoms.
Voxing wherever I was in the world, we're always
sharing. Voxing you. Yeah, so I went to this website. It's a powerful resource, Breast Implants Illness. It's a whole website there. Mm. And there were 50 different symptoms, and I literally circled 39 out of them.
Wow.
You know? I was like, holy crap, no wonder I felt like I was falling apart. So, of course, I'm a researcher. I just went bananas into research, and I just Googled and watched the different sites and stalk Instagram profiles, and I was like, this is what I have. So number one, I felt sane. I was like, thank God I'm not aging. This is not a normal state of being.
Yeah.
You know, this is illness.
Yeah.
There was no brainer for me to say, I want these out of my body as fast as I can. The next question is, how do I find the right surgeon? Well, how do I find everything that's in alignment? I ask for it, I set an intention. I ask my masters of light to guide me. So I invoked Archangel Raphael because he is the keeper of the emerald healing ray for the planet. Mm. You know, he's a master healer and also divine matchmaker, activates divine union. Mm. So I invoked him for both, might as well.
While you're at it, surgery, explant, take this natural thing out of me that allows me to come back to my wholeness.
Yes.
So I love the synchronicities of all things in this, and that all the things that we get to journey into are to return to our own wholeness, to become one with ourselves, which allows us to become one with all things. And so even from the place you were at where you sought something to feel more whole, which actually wasn't your wholeness, right? It came, we were laughing today about the coming full circle of coming back to a place of where you're like, boobs are out. And now I'm actually I'm operating from my divinity. So as we remember who we are, we get to learn to align to our divinity, which you said, it's like you become so used to and adjusted to what feels normal just from what you've seen and experienced, and we forget, or we've never known, or we're learning to remember what actually is normal. Oh, my body is actually meant to operate with ease and grace, and I'm fully supported, and I'm meant to have energy, and I'm, you know, all those things. And so it's like a whole nother level of realizing the connections to it. You know, it's so much more than boobs.
It's exactly, sister. It's a next level of seeing yourself and, you know, realizing that the body is an energy field.
Yep.
You know, so...
And it has all the energy it requires.
Yeah.
So if your energy is lacking, it's from disease, dysfunction, disconnection with life, out of flow with life, etc. that creates... So obviously we're experiencing these symptoms. Mm-hmm. They're having you out of flow.
Exactly. And then I realized literally implants are positioned blocking two of the most crucial organs in your body, which are lungs and the heart. Mm-hmm. So talk about heart chakra block. Yeah.
And you said that your breathing had become really shallow.
Oh my God.
You didn't even notice, like, it just become what you were used to. Your breath was really shallow.
My breath was shallow. It felt like a continuous pressure on my chest. Mm-hmm. So when I was doing the blood work to be given a green light for the surgery, the doctor who was checking my breathing, she said, "Do you have asthma?" Mm-hmm. I was like, "No. This is my normal breathing." Mm-hmm. You know, I was like, but I am taking these things out of my body in 3 days. Let's see if it's going to change anything. Mm-hmm. And the first thing I've noticed when I woke up from a surgery, I know I'm kind of like hopping forward, is that I took a deep, deep breath from my belly and felt like I could just droid it all the way to my throat chakra.
Yeah.
You know, without obstruction.
Wow. Even I just felt that as you said it, how you said it was blocking the organs of the heart and the lungs.
Yeah.
And you, of course, there was a disconnect from the connection to your throat chakra. Mm-hmm. And you just said, I felt that throat chakra. Something I want to address as we move forward in your experience is, because you didn't necessarily maybe experience this, yet I feel like people listening that either have implants or maybe for whatever reason, they might be hearing this for the right reason to tune in, right? As to what resonates for them. Did the thought come up for you of like, oh no, I don't want to lose my boobies? Like, because I know for myself, I'll just bring this back to, I went through some deep initiations where I remember, like, I rejected my skin color, being like, technically, normally, I'm butt-ass white. Like, I'm like an angel white. And for years, I would have to use a tanner to be anywhere, go anywhere. And I validate it as it was my way of like having sunblock, because if I was out in the sun, I would burn. But if I had this tanner on, I wouldn't burn. And so, yeah, I noticed that I was attached to it. Like I was like, I felt not good enough. I'm trying to think of the
inadequate
word for that. Inadequate or, you know, not confident, etc. I felt like I wasn't enough. I noticed there was an attachment to it. I had to have it. And hence, if there's an attachment means, so I noticed as I was feeling called forth to love myself even more, it was like, there's something else. The angels would say to me, there's something else you got to let go of to fully love yourself. And I remember thinking it would pop up just slightly in my head. It's that I need that to feel like I look beautiful, or because I mean, I was teased as a little girl of for being a redhead, right? And I remember being called fire crotch or whatever it was, but it was like I thought redheads were ugly because of their white skin, and just wherever that came from. And I remember it was so intense for me that when I first became pregnant with my oldest, Sky Guy, I was so nervous he would be a redhead, because I thought, I don't want him to deal with the same. I mean, that's how intense it was in my body, my belief system, that if you're a redhead, you're either gorgeous or you're butt ass ugly. That was just, it was like, you're one of the two. And the skin color is just, you know, everything was, it's all these painted pictures in our media of like tan and da 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 da, and all these like, we look like this. And again, that's the same thing with boobs. So I'm just bringing it back to my own personal experience. I got to work through the boobie thing. I really wanted boobs. And I remember dating a guy at the time who, when I wanted them, who like reaffirmed it for me, where he was like, yeah, I mean, if you could, something about if I could buy boobs and then I'd be so much more womanly. And it just was reaffirming the story. I went into it. I'm grateful I started the journey to really go, whoa, like I shifted that to where I was like, oh no, I don't actually require the boobs. Yet along the journey, I found that I rejected my own skin color. And it was after an initiation activation, doing DNA stuff in Europe, that I came back and there was a calling forth for a whole nother level of completely radical self-acceptance and loving myself. And the little voice in my head said, let go of getting spray tans or the tanner, etc. And it was like, oh, no, I could do that. Like, and I was like, oh, interesting. So I was called to it. And I remember, as simple as that sounds, for me to just begin to like show up completely as me, I remember it ripped me open. I cried my eyes out, feeling so ashamed of myself, so ugly. And all those feelings I got to completely feel. And I remember going to the gym or to work out and be wearing shorts and having, like, I would see myself in the mirror and want to run. I was like, oh my gosh, my butt-ass white legs. And I had to start reprogramming, breathe into it, breathe into the space and be like, I am so beautiful, exactly as I am. I love my gorgeous white skin. I am an angel of light. And I'm like, you know, no one else here is looking at me. They're all doing their thing. Everyone's in their own. And I just had to reaffirm the truth and breathe into the space. And it shifted to where I like literally began to see myself as an angel of light. And I love my white skin. And now, if I'm going to be, because I travel all over the world, I'm in third world countries, I have this, you know, organic tanner stuff that I use for if I'm going to be out at the beach all day, because otherwise I can be out on the beach all day and it literally not affect me, versus I'm like 10 minutes, 20 minutes, and I'm like, I'm fried, I'm done. So yeah, I can use it out of a conscious, I have no attachment to it. And so there was that level. There was so many other things that it feels like, oh, my lashes, right? Like and again, it was like, oh yeah, this is, I had lash extensions prior to doing my global journey. And it was like, I love eyelashes because I don't ever wear makeup. So it's like, they're just boom, they're there, because otherwise I have blonde eyelashes. And that was another level of like, hey, letting go of any attachment to trying to fit a role or an image and letting those go, realize, oh, I got to love myself if I have no, you can't see my eyelashes at all. And being like, oh, I'm beautiful just as I am. So there's all these levels for each of us, I'll say, whether it be boobs or it be, people can choose eyelash extensions as a way to feel like they're supporting themselves with self-love and beautifying. And it's all true. So there is no wrong or right here. We're not saying if you choose to have implants, you could listen to this and choose to have implants. And it could be right for you. And you could also, you know, choose to have anything. It's where is it coming from? And so really, when you experience this at the time you chose in, you recognize it was coming from a place of an emotional need to fulfill a role or to look at a certain image. And so I feel like maybe some people listening to this, they might go, if they have, let's say they have implants and maybe they've been experiencing health issues and this has popped into their field. The thought of how would you say or give someone support, because you maybe necessarily, you were like, done. I see it. I see what it is. Angels told me it's out. And you move forward, because that's just how aligned you are, and to move forward and trust of the next moment and the, you know, alignment to life. And that's also why we can share how it played out for you. Yeah, what would you say to someone who's that woman who's like, ah, but I can't imagine not having my boobs.
Yeah.
And this is what being a woman looks like, feels like, you know, makes me more attractive, etc.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I would say, you know, on the practical side is that there have been hundreds and hundreds of women who went through the same journey. So there are more and more highly skilled plastic surgeons who are so good. They are masters of their craft. Yeah. So they can work with what you have and really help you with reconstructing surgeries.
I mean, your boobs look amazing.
And they're amazing. They look better than
you. I was like, babes, those are sexy.
Oh my God.
I'm like, she still has bigger boobs than me.
Yeah.
I was like, you still got like some voluptuous boobs. And that's just your natural and the skin. And,
oh.
Right. We're checking. We're
checking them out right now.
Yeah. Because I'm grabbing mine.
I'm grabbing
like, yours.
You're so good. Yeah. And I get to be, you know, I get to be patient because it takes about, you know, really 6 months for them to come into shape.
You're less than 2 weeks.
Less than 2 weeks
out from surgery. Yeah.
It is just so, so soon. But I would just say, you know, because I got to speak both to your right brain and to your left brain, to you as a whole being. So simply on a practical level, just know that if you go to the right surgeon, and I can recommend the one who is incredible master, and not only a master, very soulful, the entire team makes you feel, you know, you're so welcome, you're so supported. Mm-hmm. They make it as stress-free as possible. Mm-hmm. And then, so you will have breasts.
Yeah.
They're just going to be smaller.
They're not going to disappear.
It's not going to be, like you're going to have a completely flat chest.
I got to share something with you really quickly. I remember when I shared on some sort of podcast or interview or something how I went through breast cancer and I healed myself of breast cancer, someone said to me, oh, is that what happened to your boobs? I thought, I got them taken. I was like, no, they're still there. They're there. So, I mean, you probably end up with more boobs than I have. And I love my boobs. I'm like, I hold them every time. I'm like, I told her, I'm like, she was like, oh, yeah, being so light. I'm like, yeah, having light boobs feels so light and easy,
yeah,
right?
Your back,
I can jump around.
So good.
I can do everything. And I like, I don't wear a bra. Mm-hmm. I put one on for working out and jumping around yet. I was like, I told her how at one point, I don't know, whatever was I was going through, I felt like my body had put on some more weight and my boobs got bigger and I was like, oh man, they hurt. I have to wear some. This is not as easy. So
yeah, it's pretty amazing. And you know, another thing too, like if you're listening, if you had implants over 7 years or 8 years, you may relate to this. Like first you get them and you love all the attention you get and you just soak it up.
That, yeah.
Now, like last 2 or 3 years, I hated the attention they were getting.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like I really, it went to the point of hate. I'm using the strong word, but it's really like, you will not see any of my videos with any cleavage because I just really did not want to lead with that.
Yeah.
And I had, you know, double D's.
You shifted probably from using them from the space of this makes me worthy, I get attention, and then to where you're like, wow, I don't want to be acknowledged for this.
Exactly.
I want to be seen for my voice and my words and my message. And so you covered them up, basically.
Exactly. Yeah. And they were just getting in the way and they were becoming more like annoyance, you know, and then they were really losing shape after 11 years. The implants stretch the skin, stretch your nipple. It's, you know, I just really didn't like them anymore, you know? And then when I learned about the health, I was like, whoa. So just knowing that change is always for evolution, you can find a masterful surgeon who will do such impeccable job.
Well, I love
job.
That you brought the one side to it, which is it doesn't mean you're not going to have boobs.
Exactly.
Like I said, you probably have more than I have.
Yeah.
Her boobs look voluptuous and amazing still. And it's easy. It can be an easy process. It's now more of an awareness that a lot of people can do it. And the reason because this kept dropping in, and I, you know, Katarina is literally one of my besties, like besties of besties, divine light beings that is just gorgeous soul reflection. And we together actually co-created a course called Divinity Keys, where when we first were both super into the gene keys and wanted to create something for our peeps that guided them through their DNA map and how to do their activation sequences and understand themselves and activate their shadows to their gifts, etc. So she and I did that together because, I mean, she's just like such a Jedi. And in, you know, this process and seeing all this come through and come about, it was like to see my divine sister go from all this health issues in your body, and you know what most people would feel is fear around it. When we were talking about it, I told her. So this was dropping, and we were just gonna hang. That's my point. We were like, I'm in Cali for 2 weeks. We definitely have our sister time. And I was like, sister, this keeps dropping in. I get no attachments or expectation. If it flows, I feel like this is. And I've seen you become so passionate about this, and this was what fired me up about it. There's another divine, beautiful goddess leader that I had done an experience with an event with a long time ago, and she has breast implants. And I remembered at our retreat, so I had recently just seen her post something, and this girl that was at our retreat had asked her in our retreat, can I ask you a personal question? She's like, do you have, you know, implants? Do you have fake boobs? And she's like, yeah. And she said, I had chosen, I always wanted them. I gave myself permission and I chose to get them. I know in the last year she got actually another, like, more added, and yet it was never shared publicly. So it almost made me go, interesting, do we still shame? Are we still really striving to fit a role of what it looks like in an image? And this is why it hit me hard, is because I had witnessed your journey and become aware of all this from you, and I didn't know about it at all. And then I saw this girl that was at our retreat message on that post, yay, I'm getting my boobies tomorrow. Like, she was choosing in on getting boobs. And she was seeing as this person sharing, you know, it's a level of worthiness.
Yeah.
And again, it's just like anything. It can be, yet is it coming from, if there's coming from, I require that thing to feel worthy and enough, it's coming from a place of I'm not already enough. It's from lack, not I'm whole. So I, like, when I used to get eyelash extensions, it was like, I don't want to wear makeup and it feels easy. It was efficiency. And I also noticed where I was used to these gorgeous, glorious eyelashes. And then when I didn't have them, I was like, oh yeah, that made me feel prettier. Oh, interesting. I get to allow myself to know that I'm beautiful with or without my eyelashes looking a certain way. So it's all too, and this is why I was like, wow, Katarina, we really, if you know, you're open to it, we get to share this. And she of course is like, I'm so passionate about sharing this level of alignment. So
absolutely. You know, if I get to help one woman or thousands of women to see the light and to actually make the connection between their symptoms and the root of what's going on, it's a light switch goes on and hope returns.
Yeah.
And you know, and you step into sisterhood.
Yeah.
You step into explant family.
Yeah.
Like, you know, you see other women who went before you and how their life's turning around because, you guys, here's the good news. So many people who went through explant surgery, 95% of their symptoms magically disappear the moment you take the root of irritation and inflammation out of your body.
Yeah.
So 95% recover, you know, 3 months and more. Mm-hmm. I start feeling immediate difference when I woke up from the surgery.
Mm-hmm.
Number one, I felt my head was clear, you know, then no back pain, no heaviness, none of my joints would go numb. Like, that's another symptom I forgot to mention. My left arm would randomly go numb, or my wrist would randomly go numb. And I was like, well, that's just part of getting older.
Yeah.
That's part of aging. My hands will become numb. You see what I mean?
That's the story.
Yeah, yeah, because who's going to find the time to go to a doctor and say, hey, my hand is going numb. Like, I'm a business entrepreneur. You know what I mean? I just, like, oh, I just disregard this. But when I identified that was a breast implant illness, I went back and I was like, whoa, my joints were, my hands, my arms would go numb.
Yeah.
This is not a joke, right?
Yeah.
So that's a beautiful thing, that 95% of symptoms go away because the body is restoring itself to harmony and to balance.
It's not constantly fighting itself and inflamed, etc., which you don't even know is existing. Well, and we know a lot with, like, I believe Western medicine, it has its purpose, and there's a lot that's unknown. There's a lot of just, like, we study sickness instead of studying health, right?
Yeah.
And so it's like, this is the thing. This is just the thing to feel better, to look better. And there's not all the other things that are connected to it. And maybe, again, it's shifted in our knowledge about it, et cetera, that this is finally out in awareness. There is something I feel like I want to bring into it. And I know you still get to share the rest of your journey and experience of it. I mean, you could share, obviously, how you called in the surgeon and you called in the surgery being divine and easy. I mean, here, you did a live video the second day, the day two, I was like, you were like a live teacher. I'm like, there's my sister.
24 hours of the surgery. I was delivering an hour long live stream for my community.
Yeah, that's how good you felt. And here it's less than 2 weeks and we're hanging and playing. And I was like, sister, what can I bring you? How can I take care of you? And you're totally good.
Yeah.
I want to talk about the divine masculine.
Mm-hmm.
Like, Gracie, we're laughing at Gracie, who's
just catching the
glorious cat who's playing in, and you can hear the chimes in the background and the wind and the birds. We love it all. So it's all here, a part of our experience. I want to talk about the divine masculine in that, how do we break down the paradigm of, I thought obviously that men wanted big boobs, and that was, I know men have their stories too of what, like what a woman thinks a man looks like. And we have all these stories of what the masculine is and what the feminine is, etc. I mean, my experience personally, I'll just start with my experience, is that to have my beloved, you know, like the first time we made love was like, your boobs are so perfect, your ass is so hot. And like all the parts of me, like he loved. Because I love myself, right? And it was like when I became into complete divine union with myself, loving and accepting myself just as I am now. And yet there's still the little girl that's like, ooh, are my boobs good enough? Is my ass tight enough? Or all these little things we can have. And so I feel like the reason I'm saying bring it up as the divine masculine, meaning for those women who might have these stories, is like, what is the real divine masculine want or their experiences? Because the body, I'll share a story that feels really resonating, in that I remember one of my divine sisters telling me about how she had this experience where, again, all your stuff is going to come up to be healed. And she ended up getting, like, I can't remember, some sort of sexual disease, transmitted disease. And she was like covered in like the bumps. Maybe it was herpes. I can't remember what it was. And so it's like, she was so sore and painful, and she had to like be spread eagle and literally have help with like clearing the wounds and like getting out the pus and putting this in. And her beloved is doing this. And she's so vulnerable and open and embarrassed. And he's like, lover. He's like, beloved, it's just a body. It's just a body. That is the divine masculine.
Yeah.
There, and it's like, there's the divine masculine I've experienced, and the sacred men in my life, in our world, like, as I open my eyes to being male. Now what I witnessed as a man, or an image of a man, back in the time period when I didn't love myself. Again, I shared how I reflected. I didn't feel like I was enough. I felt like my boobs were too small. I looked like a 12-year-old boy. I was ripped and shredded, you know, personal trainer, etc. And was like, but I have no boobs. And so what I attracted was a relationship and a man in my life who reaffirmed, yeah, my boobs are too small. I should get surgery and I should probably get implants.
That's right.
So my past, as I aligned to, I remember at one point realizing it wasn't that these men weren't available. It was that's what I was attracting. It was like, oh, this is what I've been attracting.
Mm-hmm.
It's not that these men are out in the world. And as I grew in my journey, I remember having a conversation with a man who was very conscious, and I wanted to know. I remember asking him, I said, I just got to know this. Like, does a conscious man really want a powerful, aligned, conscious woman, or does he just want a trophy wife? Mm-hmm. Because I had seen so many powerful men who were standing in their power and living in their truth, and they always just had a trophy wife who she didn't have a message or a voice, or, you know, was like, I'm just here as the pretty thing. And I was like, wait, so does the divine masculine actually exist where they want a woman who stands fully in all of who she is and loves all of who she is, or do they just want something pretty on your arm? Because that's the paradigm I was coming from. Mm-hmm. So there was like, I can stand in this place, but I'm either going to have to be the one that, you know, raises up, or, you know, a man, or etc. It was like, I wanted to witness that. And that was my journey, to start to attract only divine masculine and witness levels of the divine masculine. And again, come to divine union within myself of the feminine masculine, that I could receive more support from the divine masculine. And then having, you know, again, a beloved that's like, there's never been anything spoken other than pure bliss and love and appreciation and joy, and that I'm perfect and I'm whole and I'm complete. And that's all he sees. And that's, there would be nothing else. Mm-hmm. And that's the reflection now. So I would love to bring voice to, it's like, you know, I know you have some very powerful brothers in your life, and just this idea that what exists truly is divine masculine, who, it doesn't matter how big your boobs are.
Yeah.
You know, and what would you say to that, for, because I believe that's a big paradigm as to maybe why there's a draw or attraction for the boobs.
Yeah.
Is because it's about being more attractive or looking a certain way, and that's in our society or our image of, you know, that's how we become attractive, and we attract that.
Yeah. Well, what I find in my experience is that a woman that truly has an open heart vibration is impossible to forget. Mm. And she's so magnetic. It's magnetism of the heart.
Right.
That's what the divine feminine is. Yeah. Just radiates that.
The divine feminine is not what your body looks
exactly.
like.
Exactly. It's a vibration.
It's just in men and women. Yes.
Exactly. Yes, so truly a divine masculine, an embodied man who knows who he is, he's looking for that. He's looking for that heart magnetism and heart alignment.
Yeah.
You know, so.
And you just nailed it.
All my brothers were so supportive. Of course, they were so supportive. And then I wrote this letter as a Facebook post, and I titled it a post for all the good men who care about women. And this post went viral. Mm-hmm. So many people shared, and it was just incredible. But I literally wrote to men and helped them to realize the high price of implants in a woman's body, because they typically trust that their woman has made a research. Mm-hmm. So whatever you want, honey, of course, I'm going to support you. I'm going to be, and they feel like they're fulfilling their divine masculine role by supporting woman's choice, right? A lot of men. My opportunity was to speak to a man and help them understand what the implants is doing to the woman's body, and also how sensitive women are to any comments about our body from the masculine, good and bad or none, right? How you enjoy to receive all these beautiful compliments, right, from your beloved, and you just soak it in. It's like watering a flower. Mm-hmm. But even a slight remark can leave such a scar on a woman's soul.
Yeah.
And it's very, very important for the masculine to praise a woman.
As I say, the feminine thrives off of being praised. Mm-hmm. You want to be loved and adored and cherished. And so truly, in something you nailed, I just want to bring presence to, that's what you're attracting. But you're like the divine, let's say the physical form of a man who's embodying the divine balance of feminine and masculine, has done his inner journey to be whole and complete himself. He is looking to be find wholeness, right?
That's
like
right.
Looking for wholeness, not looking for someone who doesn't feel whole to lift up.
Exactly.
If he's attracting that, it's because he still doesn't feel whole. So when you look at this, you go, wait, what am I really wanting to seek as my experience of relationships in my world? Is it coming from a place of I'm not enough, and so I would attract that? Or is it coming from a place of I'm whole, and of course that's what I want to attract? So then we can break down our little human thoughts. We're like, but this makes me feel safe. It makes me feel more attractive. It makes me feel this. But it's like, does it really? And when we, I mean, I know we're talking boobs and we're talking all this stuff, but really when we go to what we normally teach, it's like, why would we care what our body looks like?
Exactly.
We're divine illuminated light bodies and beings. We're literally, this is just the framework and the vessel, which is a beautiful, glorious gift. How could we ever shame one inch of it? Mm-hmm. One cell, one atom or subparticle. And we have all this ability to speak to it and design it, and it has ancient wisdom. It's just glorious. So why would we think, oh, this needs to be look like this so that I can be enough? Like when you see it from that framework, you're like, silly human brain.
That's right.
Holy human experience, really. The holy human experience that we have these human thoughts that are from the collective field of the collective mind. Mm-hmm. The quantum field of information from our collective that we get to heal. And as each person is doing their own healing, they're healing for the collective. So you, my glorious sister, have called in this beautiful experience and went through this healing for yourself, and then you brought voice to it. So you're not only holding the field for the collective of healing, you did your healing that helps heal the collective, but then you spread that in such a huge way with just this awareness that then now, see, as we become a new earth frequency and new human codes, we come from a place of I would never judge another. I would never resist or block another. I would never create separation. I only am in oneness and allness and pure acceptance. If I'm in oneness and allness and pure acceptance, it has nothing to do with what your body looks like, your race, your religion, the amount of money you have, etc. All these separation ways of separating dissipate. And so hence that has to start with us, right? And so really, I love that you brought it back to, well, it's just a matter of vibration. So if you're choosing to vibrate your own wholeness, then you receive, of course, the men and women, just like the only people I surround myself with are like Katarina. They're like divine besties, soul companions. We all operate in bliss and flow and ease and joy without ego or attachments or expectations. And we just play. And we're here, we called in that level of receiving to reflect life at that remembrance of our divinity, that relationships are just fucking epic and magnifying and easy and blissful and joyful. Mm-hmm. And we can drop any story of sacrifice or attachment.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. You know, it's like you outlive old identities so fast. And, you know, if you have something in your body that represents, you know, the outlived paradigm,
yeah.
it's just like too small. It's too small for you.
Too small for your energy to mm-hmm. be consumed by it anymore.
Exactly.
Because you have all the energy you require. And yet when your energy is going towards something that isn't, and this is also the micro alignment.
Mm-hmm.
You're like, now that you have this awareness, let's put it this way. You got the awareness. If you chose to be like, ooh, but I really still, you know, and you put up with it, you kept validating it like you did before when you didn't know it was the root, but it's like you kept, oh, well, this is this and this is this and this. But the moment you get that awareness,
immediate action.
If you ignored it, you're actually out of alignment.
Mm.
You're like, well, so this is what I'm tolerating.
Exactly.
I'm going to tolerate this because I think it's going to give me this. So there's a transaction, which is not in the, it's like a low level vibrational transaction. I'll keep the boobs and I'll deal with this so that I can have the man that thinks I'm attractive or whatever. Right. And so it's like the moment everything is micro alignment, the moment you were in alignment with money, if you're out of alignment with money and you owe people money and there's debts or there's things that aren't being communicated or payments you're not doing, how can you receive more? Because you're telling the universe, I can't even handle what I have already experienced or what I have. So I'm out of alignment to receive more. Same thing with the body, same thing with relationships. The moment you go, ooh, I'm tolerating something, this actually doesn't feel good. And I'm saying, well, I've got to put up with this or I'll deal with this. This is just reaffirming our level of settle, sacrifice, all those things. And you operate this way. And we both live this way where it's like the moment we feel something, cool, how do I take action on that?
Mm-hmm.
So you literally just chose to take action.
Yep. Mm-hmm. I chose to take action. You know, the same thing, set an intention, ask to be guided to the most masterful and soulful surgeon.
Yeah.
You know, so really being intentional about everything and following the guidance, was guided to the aquaplastic surgery in Jupiter, Florida. And the doctor is David Rankin.
Mm-hmm.
I highly recommend, incredible experience. And, you know, this process is in such demand that it takes months to book an appointment. Mm-hmm. So I had to wait. I got to wait 6 months preparation for the surgery. The first one was in April. And I chose to fly all the way across the country. I live in Laguna Beach. My doctor was in Florida, right? Mm-hmm. So I chose to take a week because you got to go for 7 days. And just decided that there is never going to be a convenient time to do this process. You just get to go through it.
Yeah. And you made it convenient because
I made it convenient.
It's the way you live. You chose like, this is where I'm called. Everything, all the details will, you move forward. All the details will come together, being fully supported.
Yeah. And it was incredible process because the right person showed up to support me there. You know, just everything was super, super easy. And Gracie, you're Gracie
playing in the background. It's all good.
Gracie. She's climbing
She's
the wall there.
To give her attention. We've been hanging out outside with our bliss paradise view of the ocean and the trees talking and the sun and the birds. We're like,
Gracie's like ignored.
Yes.
But you know, you just trust and it was incredibly blissful experience. I had the state of the art anesthesia. You have to go on the general anesthesia, which is, you know, they give you something that feels, it's really can be an incredible experience if you prepare your mind, prepare your heart, and really trust what the next moment will bring. You know, the surgery itself is 2.5 hours and then you wake up. I didn't feel any effect from anesthesia. It was like the state of the art process.
You also envision the process.
Yes, I was preparing
you felt
myself.
Totally peaceful and blissful. That's why I say, like, if you take fear into it, then you're going to experience fear. You were so in a, like, this is going to give my body its healing. This is what I'm called to do.
Yeah.
And speaking to trusting the process of life and taking that moment by moment, that next step, that then, you know, like you said, all the things showed up. And so you said you woke up out of surgery and the surgeon was like, it went better than we could have ever imagined.
Yes.
Again, she was on day two. She was on
a live stream. It's really like that, you know, it's all about how you welcome any experience that life brings you.
Thank you for bringing that in.
Yeah. Do you welcome it with curiosity and playfulness and openness? Just even starting with openness.
Yeah.
Like this, everything is a gift.
Knowing. This is for me. I mean, the beauty of you discovering this after 11 years of dealing with these symptoms, like, wow, what a glorious gift.
Oh,
we both have been through, we've been totally hanging out all day and sharing all of our recent initiations and activations with our new codes coming in, etc. And it's like, wow, like, what a gift. Mm-hmm. What a gift. And knowing that whatever life brings in front of you is for your divine benefit. Mm-hmm. And so, and I'm super happy for you, and your boobs look amazing.
Thank
and you're
you, sister.
Always amazing. And I would love you if they were smaller than mine. And I love you always.
It's
always
so glorious.
And always. Yeah.
They're so glorious. Yeah. And you know, like, my heart is so filled with just so much joy, mm-hmm. you know, with how much I will be able to channel through a healthy body.
Yes.
You know how much I create,
yes.
right? And all these creations, it just gave me, like, I see the world with through new eyes.
Mm.
And I feel, when I woke up from a surgery, I literally felt I incarnated into a new body.
Wow.
This is how drastically different I
wow.
felt.
Wow, that's big.
And, you know, it's only been 10 days after the surgery. Mm. I feel so much different already. You know, the brain fog, pretty much non-existence. I wake up after having 7 hours of sleep. I feel refreshed.
Mm.
I don't remember the last time where I would wake up feeling refreshed after mm. 7 hours. It usually would take me 9 to 10.
Mm-hmm.
But this has been 10 days and just incredible. No back pain. My arms are not going numb.
Yeah.
You know, these are powerful shifts.
Yeah.
And I'm just in the beginning of my recovery, right?
Yeah.
But it just feels like, wow, this is how fast you can step into a completely new experience of life.
Yeah. And to speak to that, how fast things can change. There is no such thing as time.
Mm-hmm.
When we allow and
mm-hmm.
we get out of the way, like you received and you move through and you're experiencing a whole different level. And so it's like, what gets in the way is the fearful human thoughts would say, well, the recovery time or the this or the, you know, what, all those little things. And when we can actually allow and lean into them and fully move through them
mm-hmm.
to allow the next step. It's always like the next inch. What's the next inch? And how
exactly.
do I create the next inch and be with the next inch and just fully lean into and love the next inch? And then what you receive is so much greater than you ever could have even figured out with your mind, because
mm-hmm.
that's the mental game. And it's really not a mental game. It's really a heart consciousness game. It's really
yeah.
an activating of your heart codes. And so when you, again, to overall all of this, it's like, you're so much more than this body.
Mm-hmm.
You are so much more than this body. We could never compartmentalize ourselves to be. It's just,
yes.
this is just the vessel we get to experience things through. And we can choose to be at peace with it. If we're not at peace with our body, how can you perform in peace with anything in life?
Mm-hmm.
So if there's any part of your body that you're not at peace with, how do you get to lean into what the stories are, the
mm-hmm.
thoughts, the things that are creating resistance that are keeping you in an underlying frequency of not enough, not worthy, not at peace with your vessel? And that's where all that, I mean, we know that that's where all dysfunction, disease, health issues come from, is a root emotion out of alignment of true,
mm-hmm.
you know, divinity, true worthiness. So is there anything else that you would love to speak to with this? Because I mean, I feel like people be like, okay, so you guys are highly supporting explants,
mm-hmm.
when really our intention here is just to bring awareness around an old paradigm
yep.
of what we think is actually, you know, maybe something that is desired, and that there's so much more to be seen there.
Mm-hmm.
And when we're all fully informed and we can come from a place of worthiness, I really don't care what, you know, I used to have years and years ago when I did my mind body transformation program back in the day in gyms and was like nutrition, fitness expert, mindset expert on ABC4. I had some of my trainers who got implants
mm-hmm.
and they were like, I wanted used to feel worthy. I had no idea anyone ever experienced health issues. And maybe some people aren't. Because
mm-hmm.
I wonder if there's some people that aren't experiencing health issues.
Exactly.
And they might not. And so we're not here in any way to say
mm-hmm.
this is good or bad, wrong or right, truth or untruth. There is, I mean, you experienced a doctor telling you these are completely safe, and then you found out other things, you
mm-hmm.
know? The doctor could have believed they were totally safe.
Absolutely.
And that's where maybe society was at the time.
Mm-hmm.
So I just want to clarify that we both live in a place where we completely honor
mm-hmm.
every single person for whatever consciousness they're in, whatever journey, whatever experience, whatever their reaction or their
mm-hmm.
result or life they're living, etc. And we're in high support of everyone tuning into their own truth.
That's right.
Whatever your truth is, whatever is calling you forth, whatever in your soul is calling you forth. If you're listening to the show, it's probably for a reason.
Mm-hmm.
Whether it be to in whatever way that this is for you. You know, we're just sharing your journey. And that's obviously right. My journey of, I mean, there's boobies, there's the skin, there's the extensions, yeah. There's all the things that we get to go, ooh, whenever I gained any amount of weight, it was like, oh, could I learn to completely love myself and lose attachments or stories to what my body had to look like, what working out had to look like. I learned to design my body based on talking to my cells. Like, so many stories are layered into our bodies because we get from the time we're born. It's very much in our field of this is what is attractive. This is what you should look like. This is what you should act like. This is what everyone desires, and the commercialism and the marketing. And how do we shed that paradigm is to be willing to shed it for ourselves. Mm. We get to be the frequency of I am whole and complete no matter what I look like, no matter what I'm experiencing. You know, I always deserve more love. Even if I'm in my lowest of lows, I deserve more love, not less. Mm. If I'm in my shit, I deserve more love, not less. If I'm in any experience, I deserve more love, not less. Mm. And the same is true for any human being, any of us in our journey. And so really, this isn't about you should get explants.
That's right.
This is definitely about let's be more aware of how we tune into ourselves, mm-hmm. how we honor our own truth, how we're designed, how we're made, what our bodies are actually calling forth, and just bringing awareness and true, transparent, vulnerability, authentic conversation about our experiences with it and about our journeys with our bodies and literally falling in love with ourselves.
That's the beautiful side effect of actually doing this work and asking yourself these deep questions is you fall into a deeper romance of who's your true self. And I was sharing with your sister today.
Talking about our luscious love affairs with ourselves.
Luscious love affair. It is like,
I'm like, did it involve a sex toy? And you're like, yeah. And I'm like, me too. It's so good. I only require myself. 10 orgasms, 10 squirts all in a row.
It's so good. You know, like I did a live stream yesterday, mm-hmm. you know, for my community, and I watched the replay. I usually watch my own live streams to see where, you know, where the delivery went really well, you know, where the message went really well.
You're so good. I'm just like, whatever comes through. It's off in the ethers.
I really enjoy that as an objective experience to see. But I saw myself in a completely new light last night. Oh. I saw myself with such unconditional acceptance and like total enchantment. Like I literally felt enchanted.
You are extremely enchanting. Like people, I remember the first time I heard her voice, I was like, that. Who is this magical being? I felt so drawn to her. And we have obviously a very sacred soul contract with soul family and soul companions. And I remember when we first started doing live streams together for our Divinity Keys program, everyone was like, I love her voice. And she's just luscious. She's gorgeous. It's just like, people just want to watch you, and she just emits light. In fact, one of the people that were just in my retreat, I had a retreat here in California. She went through the retreat, and then you had your surgery. She lives in Florida, and I didn't even know. She ended up volunteering. She reached out. She wanted to come support. She like brought you a smoothie or took you for a smoothie. So I'm on an integration call with my group that just mm-hmm. went through my medicine retreat and sacred sacrament. And she's like, I gotta, because she knows we're divine sisters. She's like, I gotta pick up Katarina and take her for a smoothie. And she was like, she was emitting so much light. I missed my turn twice. She's like, I had to do a U-turn because I was so like, and I'm like, yeah, that's as light beings, mm-hmm. when we are so fully emitting our own wholeness and divinity, we just exude so much light. Other people go, whoa, I feel that frequency and that light. We're holding it for the field of collective. But I just want to say she's already like super enchanting. And I mean, even though you're expressing all this stuff that you were experiencing, this is what's beautiful about it is you are still a very successful, high level leader for the world. And you were doing it at that level mm-hmm. with your body experiencing these things.
That's right.
And so, of course, our journey is we get to receive more. Mm-hmm. We only get to receive more love, more bliss, more joy, more laughter, more play, more abundance, more prosperity, more sensuality, more joy, juiciness, pleasure, you name it. All the good things. And so, of course, this came up in your field so that you could align to mm-hmm. operating even more ease, more grace, more flow, etc. And so I can see you're like, wow, I'm even more enchanting. I'm like, wow, it's possible. She's even more enchanting. And, you know, in 90 days, she'll be even more enchanting because we just keep emitting more light. Mm-hmm. And you and I have both experienced, we've actually laughed about this. I know we did a live stream about this where people have asked us, what do you do with your hair and your skin, yeah, and et cetera? And we're both like, we just keep emitting more light. We just, so yeah, even though you talked about feeling internally like you were aging, mm-hmm, you look so young and youthful and beautiful, mm-hmm, because you've done the inner journey, mm-hmm, of shedding the Shakti, the emotional stuck energy, clearing the cells, literally aligning to communicating with your ascended masters and angels and being a light being, that what happens is your cells emit more light. Mm-hmm. And as you're emitting, and your enlightenment to be in light, you're emitting more light. You just literally become light. And people constantly say to me now, you're glowing, you glow, you know, like they
That's
watch
what
something.
I hear, yeah.
And they're just like, wow, you're just bright. I all the time know people, you're bright. And so we would get asked anti-aging questions and mm-hmm, we both would be like, it's alignment. It's light. It's not even like, what do we use for our hair? What do we use for our skin? So it's beautiful that activated even more. And I just want to bring presence to, I mean, you're already such that being. And this is also beautiful for people to see that each of us.
That's right.
What someone might see as a leader or someone who, we're going through our own initiations and activations. We're all human. There's no separation between where you're at and where we're at. We're just experiencing different levels of experience and consciousness and contracts and choices, etc. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you are even more enchanting, I think, because you feel more in alignment with yourself.
So in alignment. Yeah.
You grab your words. I feel so good.
But, you know, I'm in that stage of healing where my incisions begin to itch because, you know, the healing is happening. Yeah. So I'm holding them like, oh, heal babies, help. Yeah,
I
and that's the beautiful thing. You begin to communicate to your body in such a different way. You know, like I literally communicated to my lungs, to my heart, I communicated to my liver. Mm-hmm. You know, before, like months before the surgery, I was imagining that emerald divine light, emerald healing ray is surrounding every organ of my body, restoring myself to harmony, right? Which brought me to a completely next level of intimacy with my body consciousness. Mm-hmm. So I feel more integrated and more intimate with this beautiful,
sexy,
physical,
beautiful vessel that we get to utilize, right? And that's what I say, when you truly go. So it might be that this surface symptom comes about to lead you into whatever it is, whatever part of your body you don't feel at peace with, is all just a calling of what gets to come forth for you to now heal and love, that you come into total love and peace with your vessel in every inch of you. And that is like, I don't know. I mean, I was about to say, I don't know how to describe it, but I feel like it's beyond words. It's frequency to be so in love with yourself that you feel so fulfilled and so satisfied and so complete. There's nothing lacking or limiting. And that's why it is like, wow, yeah, to touch myself, I can give myself my own touch. Mm-hmm. And we can also be in that place of full love for ourselves, able to receive the love and the joy and the pleasure and, you know, all the reflection of our wholeness. So it is such a journey of what this is really about is body consciousness. It's really about our level of consciousness, because heaven is a state of being, because it's a level of consciousness, right? Heaven is a state of consciousness. Mm-hmm. So when you're in heaven with your own body and you're in complete peace with your own body, how does that exude in your entire world? Mm-hmm. Everywhere, everything.
Yeah. Wow. So good. So good, sister.
Is there anything else you want to share around this?
I feel complete.
We did a good
We did a really good
aspect, good overview.
and very multidimensional overview.
Yeah.
You know, I savor this experience. Mm. I look at the body in a different way. You know, I look at my women sisters in a different way. I'm just so grateful for this experience. No regrets. You know, I know I chose this experience on a soul level. I really felt this was a powerful initiation process or galactic surgery, you know? So no regrets, only so much wisdom extracted through this experience.
Right. And so not to say, oh, I chose implants and it was a bad decision.
No,
there is
no
such
not
thing
at all.
Exists. It's
not
totally
at all.
Honoring.
We're never stuck. Yeah. We're never stuck.
Always for us.
You know, exactly. Yeah. Exactly. If we helped somebody today to see their body wrestle in a new light, I feel we reached a good milestone.
Me too, my love. Thank you for doing it. And I want to just honor you. I mean, I will always be a reflection of just pure awe and love and unconditional love and support and acceptance, and love you always and always. And it has been beautiful to witness you go through this journey and how, I mean, Katerina and I have been through, I mean, we've only actually known each other physically and it was much less than that, even more than when we met physically, but for a year and a half, And we've been through such a journey together.
Yeah.
And, you know, both witnessing each other all over the world doing our, and, you know, we were in Hawaii doing ISIS activations and playing for her birthday. And I would see Katarina literally get a download and just move and really like give a gift to the world. And so witnessing you go through all this, again, I wouldn't have known anything about it if you weren't someone who was so willing to be vulnerable, authentic, transparent, and truthful with sharing what you were personally going through. Mm-hmm. And that's the thing. It's like all things, like vulnerability is the greatest gift we have to give, and all things are okay.
Yeah.
There's no mask to wear. Transparency is there's nothing to hide and there's nothing to prove. And I just want to honor you, sister, for being willing to and feeling the call to share. So, cause I was like, wow. I mean, I felt it in my heart, a bit of sadness for this, you know, person being like, maybe they don't know what you, all that you've been through, and they're choosing in on this thinking it's, you know, a level of something for them that actually might not be of the highest alignment for them. And so just to bring this awareness, and I love that we get to, you know, like you said, if help even one woman or one person, man or woman, tune into their body consciousness and falling in love with themselves in another way and seeing any aspect that isn't in highest alignment. So thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you for, I mean, this is so fun. This is just play for us.
So fun. Fest.
Yeah. We're like, if it flows and all, no attachment expectations, yet this felt really important and really valuable for the world. And so I honor you for this divine contract and this choice that you made to have this experience that then you could liberate so many beings by sharing your experience. So thank you for that. And thank you for sharing here.
Thank you, sister. And it's a joy and it's also a duty to give it a voice. And you know how many messages I already got from women who were suffering in a silent suffering for years. Yeah. And I said, I'm explanting, you know, a person who attended your retreat, she's explanting literally in a few months. I'm just honoring names to keep people's privacy. Yeah. But yeah, there's at least 10 or 15 women who chose to explant since hearing my story. Yeah. And this is like, this is why we do it. This is why transparency and leadership, it's not an option. It's the way to serve, especially right now where people are bombarded by information. You know, it's just a lot of chaos in the digital world.
Yeah.
This is really powerful where we get to just share the real life experience. Mm. And because the wisdom is not only for you to receive, but it's also for the world.
Yeah. And leaders go first by healing themselves. You can't be it without being it. And
that's
so you get to be it and you truly honor the initiation and the journey and be it fully. And just you do it so beautifully. And so I appreciate your example to the world of also just trust and surrender and allowance and operating from these codes of your light and divinity to know, oh, for my highest good. And it's amazing. So thank you for sharing.
Sister.
Yeah.
I'm so excited to hear the replay.
Yeah. Awesome. So we're so happy you guys joined us. Thank you again for being a part of the Awaken Being Conversations Create Change. I'm sure we're going to go play. We're going to go play with Gracie for a bit.
Yeah.
So we love you guys. Have a fantastical, amazing, wonderful day.
We love you.
And we'll see you soon. Thank you, my friends, for joining me for another amazing conversation to create change. To allow that change to take place, please integrate the tools so that you can really receive the change into your life. And I invite you to join us for even more in the Best Life Tribe and continue on your path and your journey. And remember who you really are, a divine being that is already whole, already worthy, completely deserving, and fully capable to now claim and live the life you love.